There's a verse that we're looking at that's guiding us through these next few weeks in this series that we're in. I was hoping you'd read it aloud with me. It's from Matthew 5:16. Jesus is speaking. He says, in the same way, let's read together. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. It's good for us to personalize it, turn that around and tell ourselves that I need to let my light shine before men, that I might see my good deeds and glorify my Father in heaven. How do we do that? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus lays out a lot of things. And we're going to look at a few of those, but some other things, because what we're looking at is kind of the opposite of the seven deadly sins. You know, sin brings darkness. So how do we bring light? We want to look at that. Last week, we looked at the light of humility, the opposite of pride. Today, we want to look at the opposite of wrath, which is often characterized by as mercy. And the Bible has a lot to say of it. In fact, right at the, near the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus lays out what we call the Beatitude. He talks about what the blessed life looks like. And one of those, he says, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Before we talk about mercy being the opposite of wrath, I think we need to address a question that may be on some people's hearts. Maybe it's on yours. That is, if wrath is bad, if it's sinful, then how come we read so much about the wrath of God? It's a good question. We get a hint in Ephesians 4:26. Paul says, in your anger, do not sin. The problem with human beings exhibiting wrath is that we don't know how to handle it. Acting in anger quickly leads us down some very dark and bad paths. Imagine wrath as a power tool. Power tool in the right hands can help build a house. Power tool in a toddler's hands is a whole different matter. Imagine yourself just for a moment in a nicely painted house. Maybe it's yours, maybe it's a house you're visiting. And suddenly you notice your toddler has a permanent marker without the cap. Terrified, aren't you? Just a marker. Imagine it's a skill saw or a drill. The damage they could do to property, to themselves, to other people. Because they don't know how to handle it. And you and I don't know how to handle it. We're like toddlers compared to God. And we don't know how to handle this wrath. In God's skilled hands, wrath is a righteous justice meted out with the skill of a neurosurgeon. In our hands, it's a scene out of a Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie. It's just ugly. Very ugly. Here's a theology moment for you here. So we're going to go a little deep for just a little bit in this quote. In the total biblical portrayal, the wrath of God is not so much an emotion or angry frame of mind as it is the settled opposition of his holiness to evil. Accordingly, the wrath of God is seen in its effects, in God's punishment of sin in this life and in the next. These afflictions include pestilence, death, exile, destruction of wicked cities and nations, the hardening of hearts and the cutting off of people of God for idolatry or unbelief. And the day of wrath is God's final judgment against sin, his irrevocable condemnation of impenitent sinners. God can handle it. God can deal out wrath because God is holy. He is mature, he is perfect. He knows people's hidden thoughts and motives, secret actions, and he knows when and how to mete out a proportional response. Some people today are struggling with the concept of a wrathful God, a God who would exhibit any wrath at all. And if that's you, let me take you back. Let's go back to the early 1940s when Germany was in the midst of its genocidal march on humanity. Wouldn't you have loved to have seen some wrath in that moment? Wouldn't it have been appropriate if God had just plague after plague stopped them in their tracks? You remember that movie, that scene in the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark? Spoiler here, but if you haven't seen it, it's about time. But they're getting ready to open the Ark of the Covenant. And all these Nazi soldiers are there, and scientists and officials, and they all want to see what happens. And as they open it up, at first they realize, oh, it's just nothing sand. And then all these things begin to come out of there and terrify everybody. And then just lightning-type bolts just go out and strike down all of the Nazis in that moment. Anytime I've watched that scene with anybody, no one ever said, oh, those poor guys. How mean of God to do that. Now we're like, yeah, why? Because those were the bad guys. Those were the murderous bad guys. And a little wrath was not a bad thing in that moment. But with us, wrath is indiscriminate. It leaves wounds that do not heal. It wrecks relationships. It destroys families. That's why both the Old Testament and the New Testament reveal a God who is merciful and who calls us to mercy. The prophet Hosea quoted God as saying, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. And the prophet Micah said, he has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Jesus then took this even deeper. And he showed us what mercy looks like. And if we go to the Sermon on the Mount, there's a passage that while it does not use the word mercy, you can just see it infused with mercy. Mercy is the foundations of these things that he's going to say. So let's look at it. Chapter 5, verse 38, it says, you have heard that it was said, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. And if you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? But be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now that word perfect in the Greek there has the idea of completion, of maturity. Remember I said we're like toddlers? If we try to compare it to God, they say we need to grow up. And as we grow up, we learn how to do mercy rather than wrath. So how is it different? Let's break out some of these pieces here and take a look at them. Let's go back to verse 46. Jesus said, if you love those who love you, what reward will you get? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? While wrath will reject, mercy will accept. Wrath, when it rises up within you, wants to push people away. It wants to reject them for whatever reason, but mercy accepts. That's a key concept for us. We see Jesus living it out and says, well, in Matthew 9, Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house. He had just called Matthew to follow him, and they went to Matthew's house for a deep meal. And it says, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked the disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. He's quoting from Hosea. For I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. There is no light that shines when we love only those who are like us. When we love only those we approve of. Let me illustrate this on both a macro and a micro level for you. Nation after nation, ours included, wrestles with the outsider, with the other. Whether it's a difference of language, of skin color, of traditions, religion. When we feel threatened, what do? Wrath rises up and wants to reject, to push away. But mercy calls us to go in another direction, to accept, to love, to welcome. Closer to home, no relationship can thrive without mercy. Husbands and wives have to breathe mercy like air, inhaling and exhaling it, giving it and taking it. Marriage without mercy will be short-lived or miserable. A child that grows up in a home without mercy will learn to be either hard-hearted or thin and brittle, breaking at every wrong move, constantly in fear of being cast out. Mercy says, come in from the cold. Come in from the cold. Have a seat by the fire. You are welcome here. Now let's look at another part of that passage. You've heard that it was said, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on one cheek, give him the other one. Now, an eye for an eye has been misunderstood for a long time. It's often portrayed as a violent response to wrongs. In truth, what it was doing was introducing proportional justice. If you knocked out my tooth, I wasn't free to knock out all of your teeth. And it really wasn't about eyes and teeth. It was about just making sure that the punishment, the discipline, whatever, met the wrong, that you didn't go overboard. As our nation wrestles with criminal justice and prison reforms, it's something we need to consider. Is the punishment, the discipline, being meted out proportionate to the crime? There's another aspect I want you to think about here for just a moment and consider this, that the turning of the cheek must be qualified. This is not an excuse to abuse or be abused. Some people, unfortunately, find themselves in a relationship where they are being abused. And this verse may sound like saying, well, you just got to keep putting up with it, ladies or men, whatever. You just put up with it, put up with it, put up with it. Particularly if it's violent. This is not a cover for that sin. This is not what God is asking you to do. So what we see instead is that while wrath wants to punish, mercy wants to restore. Wrath, when wronged, will say, we need to make that person hurt. Mercy will say, no, we need to right this wrong. We need to restore the relationship, restore the person. There's this great story in the book of Acts. Paul and Barnabas went on their first missionary journey. They went around their area they were in, and they planted a number of churches, and they kind of circled back and made a report. And then they decided to go back on a second journey and visit those churches and encourage them and see how things are going. Well, there was a young man by the name of John Mark who went with them part of the way on the first journey, but turned around and went back. He wasn't sent back. He essentially abandoned them. And so when it was time to go, Barnabas said, let's take John Mark again. He's ready. He's grown. Paul said, nope. It says they had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed for Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and left. Commended by the believers to the grace of the Lord, he went through Syria and Cilicia and strengthening the churches. It's good for you and I to be reminded that Paul was not perfect. And I think in this moment, he leaned into wrath. Barnabas leaned into mercy, because that seemed to be the way that Barnabas went. And we know that later, Paul and John Mark were reconciled and were working together again. When I'm in a disagreement or with a conflict with somebody, I have to ask myself a key question. Do Do I want to be right with the person? Or do I just want to be right? It's a good question. You might think about it, if you've got a little conflict, maybe it's with the person sitting right next to you. A little disagreement going on, and you're running through all the ways that you're right, you're right, you're right, they're wrong, they're wrong, they're wrong. Ask yourself, am I just interested in being right? Or do I want to make sure that I'm right with this person? This is not ignoring truth or what is right and good, but we have to ask ourselves, what's my motive here? Because if I want to be right with the person, we'll have some hard conversation, we'll work it out. But my end goal, my outcome that I desire will be a restoration here. If we go on, verse 40. Jesus says, if anyone wants to sue you, take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go to 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you. Wrath in response to being told, asked to do something you don't want to do, will withhold. But mercy will want to give. Like a little child or a seagull in a Pixar movie, wrath lashes out and says, that's mine. Mine, 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 mine. You can't have it. It's mine. I know I wasn't looking at it. I know I wasn't touching it. I wasn't even dealing with it, but now it's mine. Mercy. Mercy looks beyond the self. It asks that hard question, what do they need? What do I have that I can give? One of Shakespeare's most famous monologues is found in The Merchant of Venice. And the first few lines of that monologue are often quoted. You may have heard this in part somewhere along the line. The quality of mercy is not strained. That is, constrained, is not limited. It droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. It is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. Do you see that? Both the giver of mercy and the receiver of mercy are blessed. Maybe it's your time. Maybe it's your energy. Maybe it's your skill set, your finances, whatever it might be. Do you clutch it tightly and say, it's mine? You can't have it? I'm not sharing it? I earned this. I worked for this. It's mine. When you hear that voice rising up within you, recognize it for what it is. That's wrath. Ask yourself, what would mercy say? What would mercy have me do? If you can share it, if you can give, go the extra mile, you will find not only do you bless, but will be blessed. Here's another one. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor, hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Seems pretty clear to me that wrath hates, mercy loves. Wrath will hate, mercy will love. You remember last year, it was about this time, people were posting their senior picture from the year then they were a senior in support of seniors of last year who were kind of losing the tail end of their senior year. And as I saw these different pictures posted, there was a thought that went through my mind, and that is that fashion is a fickle mistress. Exhibit A, this is me in 1978. Just getting ready to head off to the disco, break out my John Travolta moves. It was semi-fashionable then, not so much now. You know what's fashionable right now? Hatred. Hatred is very fashionable. Republicans and Democrats are supposed to be hating each other. Conservatives and progressives are supposed to hate each other. White people and people of color are supposed to hate each other. Poor people and rich people, masked and unmasked, are all supposed to hate each other. And if you're not exhibiting hatred at the other side, do you really care? And our world, though, is crying out for the beauty of mercy-fueled love. Our inner cities need mercy. Our suburbs need mercy. Our drug addicts need mercy. Our police need mercy. Our politicians need mercy. Oh, yes, they do. Our teachers need mercy. Our students need mercy. Your boss needs mercy. Your coworkers need mercy. Your spouse needs mercy. Your children need mercy. You need mercy, don't you? Can you give that mercy? Not on your own. Not on your own power. We just don't have it within us. That's why there's such a shortage of it. But the one who is worthy to dispense wrath took God's wrath on himself so that you might be able to have mercy and share mercy. He was rejected so that you can be accepted. He was punished so that you might be restored. He gave up everything that you might receive everything. He was hated so that you could be loved. Listen to Paul in Romans. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Maybe you find it hard to accept mercy or to give mercy, both. Reflect on what Jesus did so that you might have mercy. Just a few moments, we're going to take communion. And I hope that as you see in that bread and that cup, juice, you see the reminders of God's mercy for you. You can be reminded how he was punished, rejected, how he gave up everything, how he was hated. All of that is right there in those two little elements. And as you take them, give thanks to God for his mercy. And then ask yourself, who in my life right now needs my mercy? And ask God to give you from his well of deep riches, of deep mercy, to provide you the power to show that person, those people, whoever it is, the mercy that you first needed and now they need. Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that in this moment we can remember the sacrifice that was an act of mercy on our behalf. Jesus receiving what we were due so we don't have to. Lord, help us to be a merciful people. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.